Good morning. It's like, don't stop now. Good morning. It's my pleasure to welcome you to Community Church of Vincennes. You in the sanctuary and you watching online, maybe on vacation. And we know God's church has no barriers of walls, so we welcome you all. As we think about worship this morning, I want to share with you the lesson I learned from the toad. I learned it yesterday morning, as a matter of fact, and it reminds me of my attitude as I come to worship. I was in the shop, and the rain was pounding down, and the soybeans on the sand was drinking it up in appreciation, and as I stood and watched the rain, here come this little toad, in out of the rain, just coming into the shop door, and he just stopped to rest. I guess he thought it was a toad strangler out there. And he came in, and I could just tell that little wore-out toad was just looking a place of refuge and rest. And that's what I like about Sunday morning. It's my time to come in out of the storms of the world and find some peace and presence of the Lord. So that's a thought to think about as we enter into worship. We do, before we worship, have a few announcements, and I will just refresh you, remind you to look at the bulletin, and we don't want to forget about in the fellowship hall today, there will be a fundraiser, baked goods, and lemonade for the Isaiah 117 house. So everybody take the opportunity to support that wonderful cause. The Mary Marthas will have a guest speaker on the 19th. The details are in the bulletin. And we need to save this date on the go with Isaac Joe beginning a bingo fundraiser, and the details are in the bulletin. And one last but very important announcement. There's been a lot of people ask about the church directories. And we've been informed that they are not quite ready yet. There were corrections to be made and details to get in alignment. So they will be available very soon with one per family. Is that pretty well covered? So as we enter into worship this morning, I am reminded of the psalmist. He said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And he goes on, for the sake of my brothers and my friends, I will now say, may peace be with you. Let us go to the Lord in prayer.
Good morning. Let's pray. Good morning, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is, as always, a blessing to be here in your presence today. And Father, we ask that you would help us to set aside our cares and our concerns that we might focus upon you, that our hearts and ears, Lord, and mind would be ready to receive all that you have for us today. We thank you, we praise you, and give you our hearts, and we give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
I invite you to rise for the first song this morning. And if you're at home, you can stand up. And if you're in front of a window, make your neighbor wonder what you're doing.
Everyone needs compassion. That's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Yes, I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the you find me, all my fears and failures, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender, yes, I surrender. The mountains, my God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. You're my Savior. You can move the mountains. God, you are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. And conquered the grave. Yes, you conquered the grave. You are mighty to save.
At this time, we have a video, right, Pastor? It says we do.
Yeah, let me talk about this a minute. All right, so we've been talking for quite a long time about being a witness. What does it take to share the gospel with somebody? That if we want the church to grow, if we want the community to change, if we want our families to know about Jesus, we've got to be willing to actually talk about this. And so I've gone to some of the young people in the church and asked them a question. What would you say to a friend who wanted to know more about Jesus or asked you about him? What would you tell him? These are some of their answers.
Sophia Magruder. Things I would tell about Jesus is Jesus died for us, Jesus would never abandon us, and he loves us so much. My favorite Bible verse is Psalms 23 because it reminds me of Jesus and my grandma.
My name is Jeremiah, and if I was going to tell someone about Jesus, I would invite them to my church to learn about God. That he goes wherever you go, and he's in your heart wherever you go to.
That we love him, and we have to respect him, and we listen to Jesus.
All right, is that just too cute or what? We have more, so we'll be presenting those over the coming weeks. So stand by.
As we come to this time of prayer, do we have a lot to be thankful for or what? We are truly a blessed people. This is a time of prayer, but it is a time for you to be invited to lift your needs and prayers to the Lord. As we go to prayer this morning, we have some special needs that we would lift up. Dorothy Edelman's in the hospital for retaining too much fluid and is very weak, so we want to remember Dorothy in our prayers. Debbie Adams is going to start chemotherapy this coming week, so we pray that it will be successful. And chemotherapy oftentimes has a lot of side effects, that they would be as mild as possible. Patty Jo Bob, how long and how difficult this struggle has been. But Patty Jo is returning to Florida on the 21st for the last echocardiogram that will be conducted on the 25th. And to see the doctor on the 30th. So we join her in experiencing a miracle. And God is certainly a God of miracles and blessings. We're thankful. Shelly last week, our music director, went all the way to Texas and back. And she had a truly good time. Where's Shelly? Yeah, I have an amen over there. And so we're thankful for that, and we're thankful for you. And at this time, I would invite you to join me in prayer as you, in your way, lift to the Lord your needs, your silent prayers, as we go to him in prayer. Heavenly Father, as always, we stop and pause in the peace and the quiet. This day that you have set aside above all the other days, that we can come in out of the storms of life, find a shelter and peace. We acknowledge you, Heavenly Father, for your great love and sacrifice of Jesus and the power of your Spirit in our lives. And we just would draw near to you, opening our hearts. And Lord, we would offer our burdens as well, knowing, Lord, that you have experienced here on earth the sorrows and pains that we endure, and you know and you intercede for us. So we lift up all those with sicknesses. Lord, we pray the power of your healing touch in the full measure of of your will would be experienced, and those healings would be a testimony to your power. Lord, we are people of problems. Lord, problems are burdens that are so heavy. Give us the freedom and the assurance that if we pour out our burdens before you, Heavenly Father, that you will give us rest for our souls and peace. Those that are discouraged, Heavenly Father, may your spirit, may the presence of your body be an encouragement right now to them. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the young people and the families of our church. We're so mindful. We live in a nation that the families are breaking down, and we just ask, Father, that your sweet spirit would put us in the right place at the right time for those precious souls. We might be that place that they can find a witness like these young people shared this morning. Lord, we cannot understand or perceive some of the situations that the young people face, the children of our nation, and we know you cry for them, Lord. You know, we know that you have put us there to be your hands and feet to our nation and our children, and Lord, we pray that you would open the doors that we may serve you to your glory. Lord, we pray that you would give us the faith to know that you're going to act in our lives. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to pray with earnestness, that prayer that you taught your disciples, that prayer for us this morning as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Let us prepare to give unto the Lord of our gifts and tithes and offerings as we offer once more another song unto the Lord. So please come and give if you have not already.
Oh,
Heavenly Father, Lord, for the great bounty that you have filled our lives with, we praise you and we thank you. And from that, Lord, we offer you these, our gifts, our tithes and offerings. Bless them, multiply them to your service and to the building of your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now we'd like to invite Tawny to come up and share King of Kings.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Filled with glory, far from heaven, you came running.
I'm so sorry. Can you start that over? We can't go with that. I apologize.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till they came from heaven for you, you were running in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb has conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth abode, shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Lord. praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
Thank you, Tawny. Now, if the children would like to come on down here, I believe Miss Cheryl has a little something to share with you this morning.
Here we go. We ready? Okay. First of all, church, I want to tell you that last week when I was gone in Florida to visit my parents and watch my not-so-tiny dancer dance her heart out in Orlando, I watched the service. Y'all need to sing louder. My mother commented. She said, why can I only hear the person directing? John, great job. But and I told her that, and she said, get some microphones on the congregation. So at any rate, y'all need to sing louder. It was a wonderful service, and isn't it a great thing? Well, hello, Isaac Joe. How are you? He's like, how do you know? I got the look. Holly, I got the look. So yeah, well, good morning. So at any rate, beautiful service, and isn't it wonderful that technology allows us, even when we have to be apart, to be together? Amen? All right, so this morning I have the message for you, and I need you to, like never before, I'm not saying when Lori or Patty or Dana have the message that you shouldn't listen. This one's a tough one to teach children, so I need you to listen to me very, very carefully, okay? So first of all, I want to share with you, a few weeks ago, I was on vacation with my family, and we had this picture taken. I'm at the beach. Can you see me? Do you see me?
No.
There, you're pointing. Nope, there I am. There I am. Can you see me? Can you see me?
Yeah, I can.
Did you see me? I'm so glad you can see me. Yeah, I'm probably the biggest one in the picture.
I can see a big.
Do you see Pastor Darren?
Yeah,
that's a big guy. That's my son-in-law. He's a state trooper. You don't mess with him. No, I mess with a lot of things. I don't mess with him. So anyways, so in this picture, you see me, and you see Pastor Darren, and these are our children and our grandchildren. So to my daughters, I'm their mom. To my grandchildren, I'm grandma. To Pastor Darren, I'm wife. But do you see three of me in this picture? You just see one, right? You just see one. So to each of them, I'm called by a different name, but I'm the same person. Yes? Does that make sense to you? Right? You have, okay. So let me set that here. Okay. Am I Pastor Darren's mom?
Yeah.
No. I love his mom, and some people think that she's my mom because she's a redhead too, but she's a wonderful woman of God, but I'm not Pastor Darren's mom. Okay, now answer this very carefully. Am I Pastor Darren's grandma? No. I'm his wife, right? Okay, so I'm still me, but remember, to my children, they call me mom. They call me mother. Sometimes they call me ma. Sometimes they call me mommy, even though they're much older than that. Mama. And sometimes when they really, really, really want to get my attention, and I know I'm not paying attention, very loudly they'll say, Cheryl! Yeah. Now, my grandchildren call me grandma, not very often, because they call me Sheesh. That's just the nickname they gave me. They know I'm their grandma, but they call me Sheesh. And Pastor Darren calls me his wife, right? So this is a great explanation of the Holy Trinity that Pastor Darren's going to share in his sermon today. So God is God. We know we have God, right? And he's existing, these are where the words get a little big, but I think you'll understand, in three co-eternal divine things, divine persons. So we know there's God the Father. You guys say God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So there are three distinct persons sharing one essence, just like me being mom, wife, grandma, sister. I could go on and on because I'm many things to many people. I hope that I am an aunt. Very good. You think so? You think so? Yeah. You just want to play, don't you? I want to play with you sometime. I think you'd be a lot of fun. All right, so if you understand that there are three distinct persons sharing one essence defines what God is. That's a big word. And the three persons define who God is. We know that God is not a part-time father, just like I'm not a part-time wife, right? God is not a part-time son, just like I'm not a part-time mother. And God is not a part-time spirit, just like I'm not a part-time daughter, right? God is always all three, just like I'm all three of what everyone calls me, right? All right. God the Father created all. He knows all. He sees all. Does that make sense? We know that God has always been. He's always been, and he always will be. He's never changing, right?
I found you.
You found me? Yeah? Yep, I'm not hard to miss, am I? God the Son sacrificed his being. Remember, he died on the cross, but did he stay dead?
No.
No, praise God, he didn't stay dead. Wait till I'm done. Hold on. That's a good thing to see. How about that? God the Son sacrificed his being so we can be forgiven and live eternally with him. So as long as we have Jesus in our hearts, when we die, we'll live forever with them in heaven, right? Okay? And then God the Spirit lives within us, and he leads us and guides us. Who is that? Do you see me? Did you see me? Did you find me? Do you see Pastor Darren? Oh, yeah. See? He did fight. Good job. Good job. Yep. And you probably recognize the little guy in the picture because he was one that was in the video and his hands are all dirty. God love him. He was playing in the sand before the picture. But anyways, so, and God the Spirit lives within us when we have Jesus in our heart. And he leads us and guides us. I think I lost my picture. What do you think? So here is a summary of the only thing that you need to remember because I shared a lot of big words with you. Bella's not in that picture. Nope, a little girl that looks like Bella is, though. That's pretty cool, huh? Everything comes from who? Where does everything come from? God. He sends it to us through the Son, which is Jesus. And then the Holy Spirit lives in our heart to lead us and guide us. Can you remember that? It's a lot of big stuff. But guess what? You may be a little older before you fully understand it, and that's okay. You just keep coming to church. And we'll keep teaching. Does that make sense? All right. Can you say a prayer with me? Isaac, Joe, can we pray? Isaac, can we pray? Can you fold your hands? I say, you say. Here we go. Dear God, thank you. You got to talk with me, guys. For the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three in one. Loving us forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Isaac, Joe, can I have my picture? Thank you very much. All right, you guys may walk to prayer and praise. Thank you.
All right. Well, as Cheryl was talking with the children, we are going to be talking about the Trinity today. And what we're starting is a series here based on the core values of the church. Does anybody, just by a show of hands, know what the core values of our church are? There's so many hands going up, it's hard to see the faces. All right, so here's the way this works. The core values, these are scriptural ideas that really shape the foundation of who we are and what we believe. We've got these, they are on our website. For those of you that like looking at our website, there are more resources there and you'll know what to do with. But in the section there at the top where you click on About Us, if you click on that, you'll see our core values, what we believe. And there's a list of 8 of them. And essentially, these are the things that help guide us as a church, whether as individuals or as committees, overall what it is that we do. It also allows folks that are looking us up to find out, well, what do these people believe over their community? And this is where you find it. And so, as I said, we're going to be talking about these over the next several weeks so that we all have an understanding of who we are and why we are, what we believe, why we believe it, so that when people ask, we know. Part of the reason why this is so important is that as we are moving forward, as we're trying to understand what it is God's calling us to be in this new iteration of community church, we need to have that solid scriptural base, and we all need to know what that is. And so we start with one of the basic principles of our faith, and that is the Trinity. And as Cheryl mentioned, it's not always an easy thing to understand. So I have secured us a guest out on location who's going to share with us in just a moment. But for those of you that like to really follow along with things, if you happen to have your digital devices on you, and for those of you that are online, or for your reference later on, you can go to the website, go to the sermon section there for our worship services. There's a bulletin there that you can click on. You'll get a digital bulletin. At the end of that bulletin are all the sermon notes of stuff you're going to hear today. It's a lot to take over or to take in at one time, and that's why it's there, so you can see that when we post it later on to our website. That will also be there connected with the actual service. Just saving on paper, we didn't print everything for today. But we are starting, you see in the bulletin there that this is beginning out of John 14, verse 8 through 11. So there's a couple of the references, but there are more. And like I said, for the full version of all that, all you have to do is just go to the our website. So with all of that said, we've got, via satellite, we've got a live on location visitor for us this morning. So if we can get Lane and Preston to connect us up and get that connection made, let's see if we can get the pastor on screen here for us. Is he there?
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me, Pastor? Wait a minute. All right, there we go. Good morning, everybody. We're here to talk about the Trinity. So let's get started. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Amazing words to describe an amazing act carried out by an even more amazing God. How then do we describe God? How do we talk about God? How can the powerless describe the all-powerful? How can the finite describe the infinite? How does the created describe the creator? The answer, whatever we would come up with, is always going to be less than the reality of all that God is. And because our knowledge and wisdom are limited, we will always fall short in being able to fully describe and talk about the one whose wisdom is unlimited. And yet we do know some things. We have the evidence of all that God is all around us, in creation and in each other. And more to the point, we have the evidence of how God interacts with humanity. Young children, unable to take care of themselves, reach out to the adults in their lives for help. Then the adults bend down to tend to the cares and needs of that child. This describes our relationship with God. When we find ourselves in need, we reach out to the one who is mightier and greater than we are. We cry out and wait for God to bend down and pick us up, to tend to our cares and concerns, and to meet the needs of our hearts. When we need corrected, God admonishes us. When family or friends fail us, God is there to support us. When we need lifted up and held, God embraces us in his strong arms. When our life seems to be falling apart, God puts it back together. And so it is that God interacts with us, with you and me, to strengthen us, to guide us, to teach us, all in order to help us grow in faith and in love, in order to build the kingdom of God. Now, let's take a look at the scriptures and see how God does interact with creation. And we begin with John chapter 1, beginning verse 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, "This is the one I spoke about when I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' Out of this fullness we have all received grace, in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known." Now, the Apostle John, in these first 18 verses, describes how God interacts and even intercedes with us through Jesus. What John is providing us here is a brief sketch of the Trinitarian nature of God. The strongest development about the Trinity in this passage is the connection we see between God the Father and God the Son. Jesus is the Word become flesh. The Word was with God in the beginning. Jesus was with God in the beginning. All things were created through Jesus, who is the Word. Jesus is the life and the light for all humanity. No darkness can overcome Jesus. Jesus came to bring salvation to all people, but many did not receive him. Yet to those who did receive him and believed in his name, they became children of God. The glory of God is in Christ, who came to us in the flesh, full of grace and truth. He is the Son of God and was made known to us by the law and the prophets. Jesus and the Father are one. Christ fulfills the will of his Father. One mind, one heart, one purpose: restore fallen creation. Now, let's look at the third part of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. John 15, 26. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. And in 1 Corinthians 3:16, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells within you? From these two scriptures, we find that God, the Holy Spirit, becomes a part of us and dwells within us to comfort us and to guide us. When we combine what we know from these passages, we begin to see that it is through God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit that we can each become children of God. And it is through the Trinity that we see the amazing way in which God does interact with us. Because when God interacts with us, God does not act alone. There is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, the three in one, the Trinity. In that the Trinity is our focus today, let's start by asking a couple of questions. What is the Trinity, and what is the purpose of the Trinity? So what is the Trinity? Simply put, the Trinity is God. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. However, the biggest problem we have when it comes to understanding the concept of the Trinity is trying to figure out if we're talking about three individuals or just one. We have a hard time figuring out how someone can be three and yet remain one. Well, one very simple example is how a woman can be a daughter, a sister, and a mom. Three roles or identities and yet just one person. We should also remember that there is a difference between our faith and our belief and our ability to understand something. For instance, we believe the sun exists, but does our belief depend on our ability to comprehend how the sun stays in one place in our galaxy? We can believe that gravity works on Earth, but our belief does not depend on our ability to be able to understand why we're not flung off the Earth in the same way we're flung off the old playground merry-go-round when it's spinning really fast. With that being said, we will attempt to increase our understanding of the Trinity. However, as we mentioned early at the start of this, with our finite minds, we're not going to be able to fully understand our infinite God, but we're going to come a lot closer. So to help us take a look at how all of this works, we're going to look at how early Christians helped one another to understand and explain the Trinity. As you see, we have a medieval diagram of the Trinity, and here we see the interaction between the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. This shield that's written in Latin teaches us the following. The P in here stands for Pater, which is Father. F stands for Filius, which is Son. And the S is Spiritus Sanctus, or the Holy Spirit. And Deus, of course, is God. Now, you see on the outside edge another phrase, non est. This means is not. So, the Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not the Father. Furthermore, we see that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit ultimately are indistinguishable from one another, as we're about to see. If we look to the inside of the diagram, we see another short word, est. This means is. So the Father is God, nothing less. The Son is God, and nothing less. And the Holy Spirit is God and nothing less. And God is essentially one. This then brings us to the second question. What is the purpose of the Trinity? Now we're going to update our diagram to help us understand how this works. In Exodus 3, verse 13 and 14, God told Moses to tell the people that Yahweh sent him. Now, it's spelled YHWH, and it's meant to be non-pronounceable. However, over the years, and as we moved into more modern times, And of course, this was a Hebrew understanding of the scriptures, and many still will leave a blank space when they refer to God. We've added some vowels in there so that we could say the word Yahweh. In using the name Yahweh, which means I am or I will be what I will be, God gave them a name that literally allows God to be whatever God needs to be, whenever God needs to be it. And it is in this very nature of the Trinity that we find the one God, who is Father, Son, and Spirit, working as one, fulfilling the will of God as one, and being all God will be as one. In my diagram, we include not only how Father, Son, and Spirit interact, allowing God to be all that God needs to be, but we can also see how the Trinity acts, or I should say, interacts with humanity. So let's follow the scripture and see how that helps shape our diagram. In John 6, verse 44, we're told this, "No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father," that is Jesus. "No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day." It is God the Father who then draws us to God the Son. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 through 7, "Blessed be the God of our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love, he destined us for adoption as his children through Christ Jesus, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace." It is God the Son who redeems us so that we can be with God, but our connection doesn't stop there. Consider John 14, verse 25 and 26. "I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I said to you." And in John 15, 26, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf." God the Spirit is sent by God the Father through God the Son to be our Advocate, our Comforter, and our Guide. Because of our own personal attempts to communicate with God fall short of our goal to reach Yahweh, it is necessary for us to have such an intercessor. Because God will be what God needs to be, God the Son and God the Holy Spirit become our intercessors. In John 16, verse 23 and 24, Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, if you ask anything of the Father in my name, he will give it to you." And in Romans chapter 8, verse 26 through 27, we're told by Paul, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." The bottom line, God the Father will answer our prayers when we ask in the name of the Son. And the Holy Spirit, when we do not know how to pray as we should, intercedes on our behalf with sighs that are only understood by God, who searches the heart and knows the mind of the Spirit. Ultimately, like little children we mentioned earlier, we are helpless to help ourselves, and so we are entirely dependent upon the grace and mercy of God. We are dependent on God's grace and mercy in order to know God, to be saved by God, and to have God be a part of us. All of this interaction results in a growing relationship between ourselves and Yahweh, a growing and loving relationship that we can freely enter if we will just believe in the one true God, who is the three in one, the Holy Trinity. And when we have faith and believe in the one who was and is yet to come, God will create in us a new heart and make us holy and new. We will become God's vessels, built by the hand of God our Creator, powered by the winds of the Holy Spirit, and captained by God the Son, who will steer us on a course to eternity. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe this far, and grace will lead me home. Let us take time now and pray.
Heavenly Father, Lord, there's much for us to understand, much for us to discern. But the bottom line is, as a Trinity, you are able to do more for us than we could ever do for ourselves. And we just want to thank you for being our Father, for being our Savior, for being our advocate, for strengthening and equipping us, for saving us, for restoring us, for setting our feet on solid ground. And Lord, may we live each day with appreciation and love and gratefulness for the Trinity, for all that you are for us, all that you do for us, and all that you call and create us to be. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
I invite you to stand for the final song this morning.
Casting down the